Hey everybody, welcome to Jet City. It's been a couple of weeks now, so it's about time to make another video in the list, the ever-growing list of the biggest mistakes people make when trying to understand jet engines. So this one will be number 3. It's not exactly in alphabetical or numeric order, but it's close. I can't say this is the third most common mistake, but it's up there in the top several. Okay, and that misunderstanding is what causes the compression of the air in the compressor. So we've got a book here, some diagrams, a real jet engine that we're building on Patreon. You can check out if you want. We got the whiteboard that we might use if I can draw something. But basically, I'm not gonna say what the percentage is because I don't know, but a lot of people say, oh, I get it. It's because of the shape of the compressor that the air gets rammed in there and it gets squeezed down. Let me show you what I mean. And it's completely wrong. Okay, what we've got here is a nice color diagram that I copied off of the internet. And then I took it to the local, I think it was Staples. I paid 45 cents to get it enlarged and laminated, and here we are. So this file is out there. If you look at J79 engine airflow, it'll be right there, and you can blow this thing up to far larger than I have it here. But I want you to take a notice, a looky-loo at this. The white pieces are the compressor blades and stators. They haven't distinguished between rotating and stationary, but the blue is the air. And you can see that the pathway for the gas, the air that gets taken in the front, goes through this passageway and comes out there. Okay, so how do we explain this? We're gonna take a look at this book, but as an aside, before we get to the book, when we look at the book, I'll show you what I mean. But it's always important to read more than one source. If this was your textbook, and this was my textbook when I was in jet school. Yes, it was. Okay, there's a lot going on this page, but this is the most important part. It's a pictorial part that I want to pay attention to. If you freeze and read this, you may or may not have your confusion decreased. It may increase it, so do that at your own risk. But I want to show this shape here. This is the inlet of a compressor. We've got the tapering down of the gas path. And these little blocks, or cubes, or cubic forms, they are imaginary blocks of air. So as the air enters, it's at a certain density or pressure. And as it leaves, it's at a higher density, higher pressure. And because the pressure is increased, the volume is lowered. We'll get to an equation in a second that's very, very simple. It'll explain this. But anyway, so the air, this is a big piece that weighs a certain amount, and as it gets squeezed down, it still weighs the same. It's the same amount of air, but it's been squished into a smaller piece. So now, everything that goes in this end comes out that end, and we want to keep the speed up, because as is stated in other places in the book, that the jet engine works by accelerating air. So by accelerating air, you don't really want to slow it down. You want to keep the velocity up if possible. So if you've got a smaller number of pieces, or the same number of pieces that are smaller, and you've got to keep them going through the duct at the same speed, you need the duct to get smaller. So that's the one in, one out relationship, and the fact that air is more dense when it's being compressed, because that's what compression means. You squeeze the same amount of air into a smaller space. Okay, hang on. Okay, I looked up on the internet thingy that air has a density of 0.0765 pounds per cubic foot. So that's how much 1 cubic foot of air weighs. So if we divide 1 over 0.0765, we get how many cubic feet is there in 1 pound of air? So 1 pound of air is roughly 13 cubic feet. cubic feet. So 13 cubic feet of air is 1 pound. So we've got our compressor. Oh, I should make the outer, yes, this is an important thing as well. The outer diameter of the compressor gas path is usually pretty straight, and the inner diameter, the inner diameter of the space that isn't the compression gas path, it increases. So it looks something like that. So we have 13 cubic feet of air here, 13, for 1 pound. So the air comes in the front and it comes out the back. Whatever goes in the front has to go out the back. So 1 pound of air at 13 cubic feet comes in the front, but we compress it 10 times. So that means that it's going to be 1.3 cubic feet. 1.3. It's going to be 1 pound of air going in there, 1 pound of air coming out the back. It has to, whatever goes in has to come out. It can't disappear. It can't dissolve. And if this is a perfect compressor, we're not heating it up. Wouldn't that be great? Nothing's perfect, but for the model, it is, that's what we're going to go with. So 10 times the compression, 10 times the pressure, 1/10 the volume. And then again, that's our P1, V1. So 13 cubic feet at 1 atmosphere. 13 times 1 equals 1, right? Yes. And 1.3 times 10, 10 atmospheres. So 13 equals 13. So P1, V1, I got the symbols backwards. So it'll be V1 volume times pressure, 13 times 1 equals volume times pressure, 1.3 times 10. So 13 equals 13. Does 13 equal 13? I hope so. Good. So the same amount of air is going in the front as coming out the back, but if we were to if the pathway was straight, a straight tube, then the air would slow down to 1/10 the speed, and we don't want that. We want to keep the speed the same. So if it comes in at 100 miles an hour, it wants to leave at 100 miles an hour. That would be a nice situation. Your compressor is just compressing the air, not changing anything about it, anything else about it, and there you go. Okay, why is it so easy to make the mistake of thinking that the compression of the air is because of the funnel-shaped decreasing area, and the air gets rammed into that? That's a mistake that is easily made when you're a little kid and you see the rain dripping off of a roof. Okay, rain's dripping off. Also works when you're plowing gravel with a grader. Anyway, these things, if you have the rain dripping down off the edge of a roof that doesn't have a gutter, okay, and you place a couple of pieces of plywood and a bucket, then the rain comes down, it hits this, all falls into here, and it all goes into the bucket. So you're increasing the density of the apparent particles of rain. It's a diagram that seems to make sense. You're collecting it and funneling it, and you're increasing the amount of water here as opposed to here, right? Also, if you're plowing a road with a grader, and all, this is all gravel, then you can concentrate the gravel to one side with a big blade. And the important thing to remember is air is not gravel and air is not rain, okay? But I think these two images that we see when we're kids or even now when we're adults, you see them and they seem to make sense. And so it doesn't make sense. It doesn't make sense when you have a... It doesn't seem to make sense that the pressure here, the pressure here is higher than the pressure here. How does that make sense? Well, you've got pressure and speed. So the speed here is whatever. Speed is one. One. Need a better pen. Speed is one. And here the speed is 4. And the pressure here is going to be 4 whatevers, and it's going to be 1 here. So 1 times 4 and 1 times 4, it's the same. You can't create or destroy energy. You can't have magic. You can't have it speed up and increase in pressure, because that's a source of energy, and this would be a source of eternal energy, free energy. There's no such thing. Let's not get onto that subject. We have enough people bothering this channel talking about that. Okay, we've got another diagram here. This is from the J65 out of the A4 Skyhawk. We tested one of these last summer, and the compressor gas pathway is right here. This is the compressor rotor. This is the outer case. And you'll notice something. The sharp-eyed amongst you will notice something, is that we've got a decrease in area from here. And let's remember that this is a cross-section. So actually, the area of the inlet of the compressor is a big, like a big donut, okay, like that. And back here, let's go right here. Back here, it's got a larger internal blockage, or, you know, the shaft. It's a place where air can't flow. And then we've got the smaller total area. The area of this is much more than the area of this. Now, I think the compressor ratio of a J65 is about, I think it's about 10 to 1. So by the time we get back here, the area of the donut is 1/10 of what it is at the front. But you'll notice another subtle detail, I hope you notice, is that the amount of sloping down, it doesn't even, it's a curve, so the percentage is about the same. But right about here, it stops changing. Why does it do that? Well, it tapers down up to here in order to maintain the speed of the air at the same as it comes in. So if it's coming in at 100 miles an hour or 400 miles an hour, it stays going that speed right to here. But then in the combustor, you see that? You can see that. Okay, in the combustor, the speed of the air has to be reduced a bit to make the combustion more stable and to make everything work better. So we want the speed to be lower, the pressure to be high and the speed to be lower. And that's why you've got this diffuser section right here, which trades a bit of speed for more compression. But also, in this straight section, straighter, it's not quite straight, but it's not tapering as aggressively as this section. In here, you've got a little bit of compression without tapering down, so the speed of the air begins to decelerate. And that just makes the job of the diffuser/decelerator, easier. It doesn't keep going 400 miles an hour to here and then instantly have to zap down. You've got a little bit of a ramp here. And anyway, so it's reducing the pressure, it's increasing the pressure and reducing the velocity a little bit because your P1 V1 equals P2 V2, because if it isn't, you're making energy. So as the pressure goes up, the velocity goes down and vice versa. So this is higher pressure, so the velocity has to be slower. Pressure and velocity are two types of energy. If you have more of one, you have to have less of the other to have the total be the same. If you have more of one and more of the other, if you have more of one and of the other, then one of two things has changed, happened. Maybe both have happened. You either have to have magic or something is adding energy to the system. Now that's the second one's very important. Something's adding energy to the system. Okay, this is the part that messes a lot of people up. I've just been saying that in a duct with a narrowing, tapering profile, a passive Bernoulli duct, the speed has to increase and the pressure's got to go down, right? That's what I've been saying. But here, we have the narrowing duct and the pressure's going up. What's going on? Well, that's not what a compressor looks like. What did I say? You have either magic or something's adding energy. And something is adding a huge amount of energy in a compressor. It is not a passive duct. And that is the power of the rotor working in conjunction with the stators, which we'll get to in just a second. Anyway, that rotor in a J65, it's a 15,000 horsepower going into that rotor, turning it, churning that air and pulling it backwards. So it is not a passive Bernoulli duct, it's a compressor. That's why the area is big here and small there, even though to a pure Bernoulli situation, the pressure should be smaller here than there, but it's much greater because the compressor rotor is there, it's a machine, it's adding huge amounts of power to the air by compressing it. So the trick is, how does it do that? And we're gonna get into that right now. Okay, hang on. Now, it really would help if I'm an artist, but I'm not, and I'm really sorry about that. Anyway, the rotor is turning, it's going this way. So we're looking at the front of the engine's that way, and it is, we're looking at the left-hand side as it's going down in front of us. It's a counterclockwise, aft-looking forward engine. So these are the tips of the rotor blades, and they're coming down. So they're grabbing the air, and the gas path is sort of large here, narrows a bit in the middle, and it expands a bit at the back. So the rotor's main purpose, is to accelerate the air and shove it into the stators. So it gives it a great deal of speed. It helps a little bit at the end, but mostly I could have drawn this with more curve so that I probably should have put more curve on this one. Let's do that. So that we're not doing any diffusion. We're just accelerating the air. I'm a terrible artist and I apologize. Anyway, the pathway is the same all the way. So it really adds a great deal of mechanical power into the air, turns it into speed, and then that air smashes into, I guess, or runs into the stators. And what I've tried to do here is, obviously the angle is different. This sets up the angle of the air for the next rotating stage, which will be back here. But more importantly, the stator's most important function is to compress the air. And how does it do that? Well, it's an expanding Bernoulli duct. This length here, the difference between the two blades is greater than up here because the blades are curved. And I'll show you a diagram in the book that's pretty cool, but it's a very subtle difference. It's hard to draw, it's hard to make it obvious. But anyway, the velocity that's imparted to the air by the blades makes it shoot through this passageway and it slows down a little bit and increases in pressure. So that's one stage. So you've gone from one atmosphere to 1.1 or 1.05 atmospheres. But it's not very much, but 1.05 times 1.05 times 1.05, 10 times in a row, makes about 10-to-1 compression. So all that's happening. Okay, so here's the diagram in the book. The high pressure is the sandy looking stuff and the liney looking stuff is the low pressure. So these are moving rotor blades. These are stator vanes. And so these throw the air at that. And you can see the subtle shaping of the blades and especially of the stator vanes, that the distance between this point there and that point there, right, like that, is smaller than it is at the exit of the passageway. So this is a diverging duct, which causes diffusion and therefore increasing in pressure. So up here, let's see, right? Okay, now this is their chart of pressure and velocity change through an axial compressor. So the inlet, this line is pressure. It's not the shape of the duct, it's actually a graph. So this is measurement of pressure. and this is velocity. So it's not 100% accurate because for each drop in velocity, there's a little bump in pressure. So this should be like a bumpy or even an inverse sawtooth in relation to this. So as velocity goes down, pressure goes up. As velocity goes down, pressure goes up. And the velocity is restored at each stage. You don't have to reduce pressure to gain velocity because you've got a compressor rotor doing the work. Without the work being added, you can't make energy. So the total energy of the airstream is increasing because it's being added to by the compressor. That's the magic. Okay, so the velocity goes down at each step and pressure goes up stepwise. This would be more of a stepwise versus a smooth transition to the outlet. So now you've gone from this velocity, right, and this pressure to this velocity and this, a higher pressure. So nothing's changed except for the pressure. And that would be true in a compressor like this one. Sorry, where are we? There we are. Compressor like that one, where you have a constant ramp up or a constant squeezing down or a constant shrinking of the overall area of the gas path. So the exit speed is the same as the inlet speed. And with real engines, as we just saw, this tapering down tends to ease off because we want the speed to decrease slightly before it goes into the diffuser. So that's how the compressor works. The squeezing down, even though the profile of the airway or the hallway that the air is being thrown down, the profile gets smaller and smaller, the actual pressure increases because the air, right there, the air is being forced through a widening pathway. A widening pathway within a narrowing hallway. Okay, I didn't say it was easy to understand. It's hard to wrap your head around it. And another common mistake that goes hand in hand with this one, it's almost the same mistake, it's very close, we'll call it basically the same mistake, is people think that by applying Bernoulli's equation to the gas path of a compressor, it shouldn't compress the air. Well, it's true, we went over that. If it was a passive duct, the air would not compress. It would actually get in lower pressure and speed up. It's not a passive duct. In that tapering duct, which looks a lot like a Bernoulli nozzle in a diagram, it's not a diagram. It's got a great, big, massive, powerful, spinning machine of airfoils shoving the air backwards, adding tremendous amounts of energy to the airstream in terms of velocity, which then gets turned into pressure by the stators. And as an illustration of how powerful that machine is, take a look at this. Okay, take a look at that. That is the first stage. Yes, the first stage of an aerospay, which means an aerospace spay as opposed to an industrial spay, which means a flying spay, a Rolls-Royce spay. So that is the first stage of the multi-stage fan. It's a small amount of bypass engine. Anyway, you see a plane taking off and it looks like it's a bird. It's light and feathery and it just takes off like magic. And just think of these jet engines as lightweight magic tubes. Well, that thing, that's one stage of, I think, four on the low pressure compressor, and there's more in the high pressure compressor. That thing doesn't even have the shaft. It's the hub and the fan blades. They are, I believe they're titanium. That thing weighs 150 pounds. I just put it there. I had to wear gloves. They're over there. I had to wear leather gloves to be careful not to cut myself on the leading edge of the blades, and I could barely move it around because it's heavy. It feels like moving an anchor or a wheelbarrow full of cement. Anyway, so that thing is right at the front of the compressor duct and it's ripping along, probably using about 1,000 horsepower to stuff air behind it into the stators and into the next stage of compression, on and on and on, as a cascade, they call it. And there's a tremendous amount of power added to the airstream, and that's how it can travel at high speed through a narrowing pathway and still be increasing in pressure. It's not increasing in pressure because of the narrowing of the pathway. The pathway is narrowed in order to keep the velocity up, because as it's being compressed, it takes up less space, and being smaller, more of it can fit in the same place. And so to keep the speed of travel up, you've got to make that space smaller. It sounds confusing. I tried to explain it a little bit. Hopefully I helped. But the main thing is, two things I hope. There's a lot of really good resources out there on the internet and in books. But also, if you're looking at one particular source of anything, even my videos, don't just go with one source. Use it as a brick in the wall, another brick in the wall of knowledge. If you really want to understand something, you need to take it from four or five or more sources. And if you want to be an expert, you got to have multiple sources, because every source is going to have their own style of explaining things, and some are going to work better than others for you. But also, you'll be able to catch mistakes if there are any. And once you are reading a professional, a good quality textbook of some kind, and you find a mistake, it means that you kind of know what you're talking about now. So that's good. So, but multiple sources is the idea. Anyway, don't make the mistake of thinking that the tapering down causes the compression. It doesn't. It tapers down because the air was compressed and now needs to take up less space. So we give it less space so it doesn't slow down. All right? Thanks for watching. It's dark now. I got to go home. See ya.